Cantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Dead Ladies Project, Exiles, Expats, and Ex-Countries by Jessa Crispin. Narrated by Amy McFadden. Prelude, Chicago. There are two Chicago cops standing in my kitchen. They are here to take me away, and I am trying to talk them out of it. I don't know if I'm doing a very good job, though, as it is hard to form a logical argument when my primary focus is on moving slowly to position myself between the cops and my oven to block their view of my stovetop. I am, somehow, more embarrassed about the pot of macaroni and cheese from a box, the cheap one with the sickly orange powder, than I am about their reason for being here. The reason being that I made some threats against my life on the phone with a friend. After that, I kind of bailed. It is not that I did not mean them. I was in a pretty unwashed and terrified state. It's just that saying them out loud was not part of the plan, and I felt like I could avoid the consequences of the confession simply by turning off my phone. When my friend could not get me back on the line, she called my sister, who called the police. The police came to take me to the emergency room. The emergency room doctors would then lock me away in the psych ward for observation. And I did have a plan. The suicidal brain is good at only one thing, and that is constructing elaborate plans for doing away with itself. My plan included not telling anyone there was a problem, so that they would not interfere. Now that they had, I had to consider them in my decision. That untimely blurt is really messing things up for me. I tried to explain to the cops that I turned off my phone because it was important for me to stand weeping in front of the George Innes painting at the Art Institute, the one where the darkening world dissolves into an orange and yellow blur. Not because I was swallowing drain cleaner. I mean, I made dinner. Would I bother to make dinner if I were intent on ending it all? But I knew if they saw what I had made for dinner, they would cotton on to the fact that I had indeed given up on life. Maybe I could benefit from a short hospital stay, from some time to rest, and letting other people take care for a while. Jesus. Yes. I am so very tired. But I see too clearly the aftermath of treatment. A hospital bill that would push me further into debt. Medications I'd have to spend a year slowly trying to wean myself off. Then there is that recurring nightmare I have of being locked away, futilely trying to convince the authorities that I don't belong here. There's been some kind of mistake. I was clear on one thing. I needed a reason to live. A plan. And it had to come from within. I couldn't just let others help me find a new stability or acceptance of my circumstances. It was my circumstances that were killing me. I was sure of it. This is how I know. No matter how securely I built my sound little structure, slowly accumulating income and a respectable writing CV, dating important men with an eye toward marriage, acquiring a varied and stimulating social life. The thought, I want to go home, would start termiting through the whole thing. How is this not my home? Is this really my life, or did someone else choose it for me? Is any of this really me at all? The questions would eat at my existence until the structure collapsed into despair again and again. Every 2 years, I would be back to this exact same spot, rebuilding my sad little sand castle in exactly the same way, surprised every time when the wave took it out. But I didn't know what else to do. I could not explain this to the police, so instead I explained that a friend was coming over, a lie, to stay with me until I got better. I explained that I would definitely make an appointment to see a doctor. A lie. I explained that I just got overwhelmed, but things were looking up. I showed calm resolve, stability, and sanity, until they got the hell out of my kitchen and went away. Perhaps the suicidal impulse was correct. But it wasn't my physical life that needed to be destroyed, only what I was doing with it. I would need guidance, but there wasn't anyone in my life I felt I could turn to. Not about this. Using my married, employed, insured friends' lives as markers for where my life should be was one of my contributing factors. That would have to go, too. It was the dead I wanted to talk to. The writers and artists and composers who kept me company in the late hours of the night. I needed to know how they did it. I'd always been attracted to the unloosed, the wandering souls who were willing to scrape their lives clean and start again elsewhere. I needed to know how they did it, how they survived it. I couldn't do it from here, this haunted little apartment with its collection of insects and rodents, with a neighbor who sometimes goes mad and tries to break through our adjoining wall with a hammer, where the sound of gunfire comes through the window every night. No. If I was going to approach these great men and women, I would need to do it on their territory. I would have to go to them, not expect them to show up here. Everything that was excess could be left. The Chicago apartment, the furniture, the books, the men, the social circle. There was only one thing worth keeping, and that was my work. A small literary magazine I had started a decade ago, and a handful of regular writing and editing gigs. It wasn't much, but it was enough to fund train tickets and shoddy Central European sublets. And it was all portable. My whole working world existed on my laptop. It was myself that was stuck. I could unstick myself, I thought, if I started flinging the superfluous away. The only things I really needed, I could carry with me. I would take myself to Europe and bring as my offering some spirits and the entirety of my past. Yes, I needed to talk to the dead. Maybe now that I was nearing the end, maybe the dead would talk back. Berlin, William James.
Here is the real core of the religious problem. Help! Help!
William James, Varieties of Religious Experience.
You're in Berlin because you feel like a failure.
I had met this man all of 10 minutes ago, and he was already summing me up neatly. I made subtle readjustments to my clothing, as if it had been a wayward bra strap or an upwardly mobile hemline that had given me away. More likely, it was my blank stare in response to his question, "So, what brings you to Berlin?" He has had to do this a lot, I imagine. Greet lost boys and girls, still wild with jet lag. Still unsure how to make ourselves look less obviously like what we are, we members of the third great wave of American expatriation to Berlin. This man before me was second on the list of names that everyone gets from worried friends when resettling overseas. Everyone I know in the city to which you are moving, not totally vouched for. I had lasted about a week before I sent emails tinged with panic to everyone on my list. He had been the first to answer. I must have blushed at the accuracy of his remark, because he immediately qualified it. Everyone who moves to Berlin feels like a failure. That's why we're here. You'll have good company. Still embarrassed, I scanned the menu for one of the four German words I had mastered and, failing, pointed helplessly to a random item when the waiter returned. It would prove to be a strange Swiss soda of indeterminate flavor. It tasted like the branch of a tree, carbonated. It was not unpleasant. I had been shooting for something alcoholic, but I was already too laid bare to have admitting to a mistake and reordering left in me. At this moment, it seemed unlikely this American could commiserate. My own failings were too grandiose, the depths to which I had fallen too abysmal. I was narcissistic in my failings, and he looked like he was doing pretty okay. He sat across from me, confident, knowledgeable. He had ordered in German. The people in the restaurant had greeted him by name. He talked about artistic projects he was working on. He was certainly sweating less than I was on this hot July day. Later, a tale would unravel, one that mimicked the stories of so many of the Americans who had flocked here over the last decade. Unable to survive financially in New York without having to abandon their writing, their art, their music, they came to a city of cheap rents, national health insurance, and plentiful bartending jobs that could cover a reasonable cost of living. He had an apartment. It had hardwood floors. A failure? My eye. In contrast, there I was, 10 days into my new city and still stumbling around like a newborn calf. I was tired of being the person I was on an almost atomic level. I longed to be disassembled, for the chemical bonds holding me together to weaken, and for bits of me to dissolve slowly into the atmosphere. It was not a death wish, not really, and not anymore. I was hoping something in the environment, some sturdier, more German atoms, would replace them. Because there does seem to be something about Berlin that calls out to the exhausted, the broke, the uninsurable with pre-existing mental health disorders, the artistically spent, those trapped in the waning of careers, of inspiration, of family relations, and of ambition. To all those whose anxiety dreams play out as trying to steer a careening car while trapped in the back seat, come to us. We have a cafe culture and surprisingly affordable rents. Come to us, and you can finish out your collapse among people who understand. Let's say, for a moment, that the character of a city has an effect on its inhabitants, and that it sets the frequency on which it calls out to the migratory. People who are tuned a certain way will heed the call almost without knowing why. Thinking they've chosen this city, they'll never know that the city chose them. Let's say, for a moment, that the literal situation of a city can leak out into the metaphorical realm. That the city is the vessel, and we are all merely beings of differing viscosity, slowly taking on the shape of that into which we are poured. If that were the case, what to make of the fact that Berlin is built on sand? Situated on a plain with no natural defenses, no major river, no wealth of any particular resource, it's a city that should not exist. It can't be any wonder that Berlin has for hundreds of years. No, longer than that. Past Napoleon. Past the medieval days when suspected witches were lined up at the city gates and molten metal was poured between their clenched teeth. Past the whispers of the Romans that those who inhabited these lands were not quite human. Back to the days of the people residing here, who are now known to us only by some pottery shards and bronze tools. Been a little unstable. It would explain the city's endless need to collapse and rebuild, even as the nation that engulfs it marches on confidently, linearly. Perhaps its unstable nature is what beckons the unstable to its gates. The Lausitzer, the Jasdorf, the Semnonen, the nameless and the preliterate, a shifting bunch of conquerors and the conquered. On through invaders and defenders, and populations reduced by half in war, disease, and the destruction of whoever pulled the short straw for being the scapegoat this century. The process merely sped up in the 20th, oscillating madly through world wars and grotesque ideas, crashing economies and blind eyes turned. It plays out seasonally as well here in the northern reaches of Germany. The lush highs of summer, everything green and tangled with a sun reluctant to leave its post at night and overly enthusiastically trying to rouse you from bed in the very early hours of the morning, crash endlessly down toward the darkness of the winter solstice. The trees that had been blooming in a state of fecund glory when I arrived in the city lost their leaves, revealing that the only things behind them were the endless concrete boxes of Soviet mid-century architecture. The sun shunned us and rarely peeked out from behind its thick cloud cover. When it deigned to, it gave off all the glow and heat of a porch light. The gray of the sky matched the gray of the buildings, matched the gray of the thick coating of ice that remained on the sidewalks all winter. I fell on it one night, or early one morning, I guess, a little worse for wear, accompanied by a man I met at a bar whose entire seduction strategy was just to follow me home, despite the fact that I kept trying to shoo him away like a stray dog. I was 6 months into my Berlin residence, and from my akimbo position, I threw the holy tantrum of a sailor-mouthed two-year-old. Fuck this city! Fuck it! Why the fuck did I ever move here, god fucking damn it?
You're strange,
said the German man, still resolutely standing by. Help me up! That's when I took my William James essays off the shelf. I found in his works of philosophy a friend, a mentor, a professor, and some sort of idealized father. It was his works on the more mundane matters that I relied on. How to make changes in your life. How to believe you can make changes in your life. How to convince yourself to get out of bed in the morning. How not to be a worthless slug. Rather than his more important pieces about war or whatever. James is now a bit of an odd fellow in philosophy, more widely influential than widely known. His theory of pragmatism and his groundbreaking work in the field of psychology make him something of a hidden mover. If you do seek him out, it's not generally in the way one reads Descartes or Kant or Nietzsche, as a refinement of the intellect or in the pursuit of one's studies. One finds James when one needs him. He makes quiet sense of the world in all its glories and deprivations, its calamities and its beauties. As a philosopher, James is able to hold all of the sorrow and violence and pain of the world in his mind and remain somehow optimistic. It doesn't wipe out the goodness of the world. It just sits beside it. It's no wonder, then, that people get a little religious about this agnostic philosopher, this man who can restore your faith in the world without necessarily bringing God into it. I sought out William James because I needed him. He and I were now separated by about a century of death, but we found ourselves occupying the same biographical eddy, bottoming out in Berlin. Here is how William James found himself in Berlin. A failure. He had tried and failed to become a painter, failed to become a doctor, failed to become an adventurer. He was not yet a writer, but he was almost certainly still a virgin. He was in his mid-twenties and painfully aware that he had failed even in deciding what it was he wanted to do. He stood there, absolutely calcified with indecision and doubt, while his soon-to-be famous friends like Oliver Wendell Holmes Jr. made decisions and started careers, and his soon-to-be famous younger brother Henry started his literary apprenticeship with The Atlantic. Whereas he, well, he fled. First to Dresden, and then to Berlin. He arrived under the pretext of furthering his education, but that may have simply been a way to convince his parents to pay for the trip, because, despite his advancing age, he had yet to make an income. At any rate, he failed to go to class, ever. Instead, he holed up in his Berlin guest house, learning German, training his telescope on the legs of the occupants of the all-girls school across the street, and failing to figure out a way to flirt with the pretty woman who played the piano downstairs. All the while, in his letters to his brother, he was alluding to a daily battle not to do himself in. James lightly fictionalized this time in his life in varieties of religious experience, passing off the breakdown to someone he knows who told him about it. He's French, you don't know him. In that work, he described the sensation of his suicidal idol as desperation absolute and complete, the whole universe coagulating about the sufferer into a material of overwhelming horror, surrounding him without opening or end. Not the conception or intellectual perception of evil, but the grisly, blood-freezing, heart-palsying sensation of it close upon one. And no other conception or sensation able to live for a moment in its presence. And while his letters to his parents hint at some of this darkness, there he mostly chats about that other Berlin experience, the roast veal and the beer and the music and the philosophy. Here is how Berlin responded to William James's time in Berlin. They built a center in his name. At the place of his greatest misery and torment, they built a permanent structure. Although maybe at this point they couldn't help it. After all the documentation they had to do of the horrors of the 20th century, maybe now it's an unconscious reflex to throw up a memorial on the site of every trauma. Well, not really a structure, I guess. More like a small room. The minute I learned of the center's existence, I sent off an email to make an appointment. I expected a hall of philosophy on the university campus, maybe in that glorious red brick so many of the buildings in James's time had been constructed with. I scribbled the address down on a piece of paper, and I took the train to the outskirts, to the University of Potsdam campus. It's situated next to the Sans Souci and its gardens, the former playground of the Prussian king. While the main path through the gardens is still marked with magnificent elm trees, most of the grounds have been allowed to go to seed. It's not a tourist destination on par with Versailles, and so it is kept in only middling shape. There is a lovely rose garden, but that is surrounded by tangle and bramble. It's been let go in the Berlin way, all of those straight German lines blurring a little into chaos. Past the garden gates, into the campus, into the main philosophy hall, up the main staircase, down a hallway, to the left and then right, I came to my destination. It was a small door. The William James Center proved, despite its authoritative name, to be the work of one man, Herr Dr. Professor Loie Gunnarsson. Or is it Herr Professor Doctor? I should have remembered to look up the proper order before I left.
It's Loie. Call me Loie.
Luckily, Dr. Loie is Icelandic and not beholden to the German titling system. The center's archives are really just the contents of Dr. Loie's office. A desk, a computer, some bookcases. Dr. Loie is slight and sandy, and he has the wonderful awkwardness that comes with too many hours spent in the company of dead men. He is, he tells me, attempting to recreate William James's personal library as part of his administration of the center, so that he can be surrounded by the same books that surrounded James. It's a devotional act couched in a scholarly one. It is an act I can understand. Dr. Loie pours me a cup of tea, and we chat about our good friend William James. Up for discussion? A traumatic encounter with a prostitute, alluded to in letters to his brother and in a journal. He did, it seems, either lose his virginity to the prostitute, or, perhaps even more traumatically, fail to. The poor dear, I say.
Yes, quite. He was hopeless with women. It seems, though, that after he married Alice Howe Gibbons, the physical ailments he was treating in Berlin, the bad back and so on, disappeared.
Were they caused by the burden of a protracted virginity?
Perhaps. The poor dear.
I am keeping Dr. Louis from professional duties, but I don't care, and it appears he doesn't either. I imagine it might be a relief for him, as it is for me, to have someone to converse with about our favorite person. Or willingly converse, as I'm sure he inflicts William James on the people around him, like I do. What do you make? I ask slowly. Of the fact that his first book wasn't published until he was 49. Part of William's freakout, Dr. Louis had mentioned earlier, sprang from an enormous need to be seen. By the public, by his friends, by his father. He wanted to assert his reality on the world, as he wrote in his letters, and it took approximately 20 years after writing that statement until he would.
Surely not.
Dr. Louis starts, but then he does the math in his head.
I guess I knew that, but had forgotten. I mean, and he could not have known he would eventually succeed.
We both sit quietly, drinking the dregs of our tea and feeling the long expanse of the years before us. The weight of uncertainty. Whether it'll be a late blooming, or whether the soil will prove to be infertile. Whenever James was corresponding with a colleague or an inquirer, Dr. Loyi told me, he would request from them a portrait. It was important for him to see the whole of the person, at least a bit of their humanity, and not only their written representation. In that spirit, I have before me two images of William James. The first was taken around the time he moved to Berlin. He looks stricken, pale, and withdrawn. It is as if he had recoiled into a permanent flinch. He looks off to the side, unable perhaps to meet the camera's gaze. There is something fractured deep at the heart of him. In the other, it is a few decades on. There is gray in his beard, and his face is worn. He exudes charm. Warmth, and wisdom. It is a William James in whose lap you want to sit and listen to stories. He is keeping some secrets, but he will share them if you draw near. It is the distance between these two photographs that is so fascinating, not simply in age, but in substance of the man. Biographers are interested. I am interested. In the Berlin breakdown, because of the distance traveled between the two Jameses and the quality of the end result. It's a favorite myth in our culture that hardship makes you a better person, that it is merely the grindstone on which your essence is refined and polished. But the truth is that scarcity, depression, thwarted ambition, and suffering most often leave the person a little twisted. That is the territory where mean drunks and tyrannical bastards come from. Not so with James. He may have always been a little hopeless with women. He sent a series of hilarious and heartbreaking letters to his Alice in the months before their wedding, in a vein that will be instantly recognizable to anyone who has ever gotten a little sullen after a bottle of wine and decided to start texting. And the weight of depression did occasionally redescend. But he walked out of that phase with dignity and great compassion. He used his experiences, both the good and the ill, for the base of his incredibly humane body of work. So then what's the magic formula? Can his transition be distilled down to a scientific protocol to be reproduced at home in your own basement laboratory? Could we use William James's example to turn our respective chemical imbalances into alchemical processes?
There are persons whose existence is little more than a series of zigzags, as now one tendency and now another gets the upper hand. Their spirit wars with their flesh. They wish for incompatibles. Wayward impulses interrupt their most deliberate plans, and their lives are one long drama of repentance and an effort to repair misdemeanors and mistakes.
William James, Varieties of Religious Experience. It is difficult today to imagine the Berlin that James encountered in the 19th century. So much of the city was reduced to rubble and ash in the intervening years. I can look at photos and get a sense of who the city might have been, but when I'm out, actually walking around on the streets, it is an entirely different place. Most of the surface of the city was bulldozed after World War II, and the unsalvageable and the unclaimed was dumped in Grunewald on the outskirts of town. The pile of junk that used to be houses, used to be bakeries and hat shops, used to be attached to human bodies, was covered in dirt, and the wild was allowed to reclaim it. Now it is something of a park or nature preserve, with hiking trails through the woods, the trees still looking suspiciously young, up and down this artificial hill. One of the only hills in this swamp turned into a city. The Germans may look like proper church-going Lutherans on the outside, but they are all at heart tree-worshipping animists from way back, starting with the pagan cults in the Schwarzwald, to the nature idolatry of the Romantic and counter-Enlightenment movements in the 19th century. It still bleeds through in their songs and in their art. A few decades before James arrived, Bogumil Gultz wrote, "What the evil, over-clever, insipid, bright, cold world encumbers and complicates, the wood-green, mysterious, enchanted, dark, culture renouncing but true to the law of nature, must free and make good again." So maybe that is where James's Berlin still resides, out in Grunewald, buried in some sort of purification rite inspired by a mysterious calling from deep within the German DNA. The wood green, making all of those horrors good again. It's a calm place. Soothing. But also policed by territorial wild boar. Stefan is giving me important life advice over cocktails. I should be taking notes. Stefan is building an opera house, or, I guess, overseeing the building of an opera house, and that seems like the type of person you should take seriously. He has in front of him a small glass of one of these Deutsche herbal liqueurs. It is the color of garnets, and it tastes like a potion. I am drinking a French 75, which I will retroactively feel shameful about later, after I learn the cocktail was not actually, as I believed, named after a really good year, but takes its name from a French cannon used against the Germans in World War I. I wonder if this is why, in this Berlin bar, it is served strangely tinted red. The bar is from the 1920s, all dark wood and red wallpaper, heavy drapery and cigarette smoke. The mystery of the place is heightened if you take the shortcut through the courtyard of some residential buildings. It looks like a dead end on Google Maps, but you can weave your way through. You could go the long way and stay on well-lit commercial streets, but then it no longer feels like a secret. Outside the bar is a poster for a performance of cabaret, a German version of an American man's musical version of a British man's version of Weimar Berlin. Bob Fosse remains the link between my previous home of Chicago and my new. I have trouble listening when Stefan is speaking, and not only because the bar tonight is loud and overcrowded, which it is. There is an army of white boys at the bar, drinking beer and wearing an almost identical uniform of trainers, jeans, and dark gray hoodie. My real problem is that Stefan's hair is so beautiful, so silvered and swooshing and glorious, that I have to sit on my hands to keep from forcing them into his mane.
Shit, what's he saying?
Don't end up like Bertolt Brecht.
That seems like horrible advice. Shouldn't the goal of life be to end up as close to Bertolt Brecht as possible? I need a little context.
When Brecht moved to Los Angeles, he had such a difficult time learning English that he gave up. It soured him, being unable to communicate, and he started to hate America.
Read his journals, you'll see.
For Stefan, every topic of conversation circles back to Bertolt Brecht, the way for me every topic of conversation circles back to William James. I take his point, which is made in impeccable English, shaming me further. I have been stubborn about learning to speak German. It feeds into my unsettled state. Why learn German if I'm only going to be here for a few years? But then, how can I know if I want to stay unless I assimilate a little and give the place a chance? It is mortifying when someone addresses me in German I can't follow. And yet, part of me likes the little bubble I live in, the way I can tune out conversations on the subway because I can't follow them anyway.
Read Brecht's journals,
Stefan repeats.
And learn German.
I do read Brecht's journals, translated into English. When he does write about America, it's occasionally to complain about the FBI coming around to talk to him. And I wonder if that had as much of an impact on his displeasure with the country as his difficulty learning the language. On March 23, 1942, he wrote,
"Remarkable how in this place, a universally depraving, cheap prettiness prevents people from living in a halfway cultivated fashion, i.e., living with dignity. In my garden house in Uting, and even under my Danish thatched roof, it was possible to browse over the Bellum Gallicium in the morning. Here, it would be utter snobbery. Lindiger saw the discussions of the 20 on the mistakes made in Spain. A few discussions with Jungdahl on Hegel's dialectics, the young workers' little masked theater which performed How Much Is Your Iron? Finland had Marlebach, with the birch coppice round the house, the coffee hour in the main farmhouse after a sauna, and the two-room flat in the harbor quarter of Helsinki, packed with good people. There was room for Diderot and the epigrams of Meleagros, as well as Marx. Here you feel like Francis of Assisi in an aquarium, Lenin in the Prater, or at the Munich Oktoberfest. A chrysanthemum in a coal mine, or a sausage in a greenhouse. The country is quite big enough to squeeze all other countries out of one's memory. One could write dramas if it didn't itself have any or need any, but it has all that, if in the most negligible condition. Mercantilism produces everything, but in the form of saleable goods. So here, art is ashamed of its usefulness, but not of its exchange value.
It reminds me of the inevitable line of complaint you hear whenever a group of American expats gather in Berlin. About the invasive noisiness of the Germans. About the way the pinched old lady who lives upstairs is always watching you and probably taking notes. About the way Germans stare at you on the street, on the subway, even in the saunas, which will be, of course, both naked and co-ed. The way they don't respect your personal space. The way grocery stores are closed on Sundays because the government at some point decided they'd rather women be at home with their families that day, and now you can't buy milk when you need it. The way they scold you publicly if you cross the street against the light. The way if you go to the pharmacy to buy antacids, you are more likely to leave having heard a lecture about the importance of a healthy diet than with the actual tablets. These complaints occasionally tip over into the word Stasi, the word Nazi. No one is proud of these moments. But no one is immune to this impulse to romanticize where you came from, where people did things that made sense, goddammit, when faced with a new culture from which you are out of step. It's easy to respond to the foreignness of your new home with indignation and, "What? I never!" James's letters home grow more and more flummoxed as he tries to learn German and interact with the natives.
"The language is infernal,"
he complains to his family.
"German requires that you should bring all the resources of your nature, of every kind, to a focus, and hurl them again and again on the sentence, till at last you feel something give way, as it were, and the idea begins to unravel itself."
William must have had to bring all the resources of his nature to hurl against the German personality as well, if his experience at all resembled mine. So many hours I've spent dissecting evenings out with German men, just to determine whether or not it had been a date. "Well, he paid, but he did not touch me, and that's the fifth paying but no touching dinner, and for Christ's sake, I have met his family. What the fuck is going on?" A friend once intervened. "If a German man likes you, he won't touch you, because he respects you. If he just wants to be friends, he won't touch you. Basically, during the first 10 dates, he'll only touch you if he doesn't care much for you." And meanwhile, they will sit there, wrapped in their beautiful impenetrability, never flashing enough vulnerability to let you know if your own advance will be met with anything other than stony silence. It is baffling. Someone should develop a code of hand signals. I wonder if James tried to make a move on a Teutonic woman during his residency, and if he was frozen by that aloofness. Though, in his letters, he seems just as desperate for the company of men as for the affections of women. He wrote home,
"Berlin is a bleak and unfriendly place. The inhabitants are rude and graceless, but must conceal a solid worth beneath it. I only know 7 of them, and they are the elite. It is very hard getting acquainted with them, as you have to make all the advances yourself, and your antagonist shifts so between friendliness and a drill sergeant in formal politeness that you never know exactly on what footing you stand with them."
There was always something that worked sadly in William, to borrow his expression, a loneliness that put him on unequal footing with men he tried to befriend. There is an element of grasping panic in his letters to Oliver Wendell Holmes, Jr., as William begs for swifter response. He was in his own bubble in Berlin, unable to communicate, unable to force communication from back home, alone with his thoughts, none of which were good. He could have been standing in the center of Unter den Linden, arms outstretched, his entire psyche unzipped, and his tremendous need spilling out of him, and the Germans would have simply brushed past him without even the slightest Schuldigen in passing. I'm not allowed to leave the university campus with the volumes of James's letters, so I read them outside, under a tree, surrounded by 20-year-olds, all of them seeming happily grouped up, greeting friends with a double cheek kiss and enthusiastic smiles. When my back starts to ache, a reminder of the age difference between them and me, I return the books to Dr. Louis's office. I take the train back to Alexanderplatz, and then I walk the mile home, to an empty apartment, furnished with someone else's belongings. I make a cup of tea, I check my email, and I feel the poreless surface of the bubble around me. I want to bend time and snatch William out of his lonely guest house. I could use the company. But I know how his story ends. He has to stay in Berlin a bit longer so that he can become a great man. And me? Who knows what the fuck I'm doing? Every James biographer has a slightly different take on the breakdown, but there is near universal agreement that it has something to do with his father, Henry James Sr. I have to say that I do not like his father. In fact, I dislike him with such intensity that it's clear I am projecting some of my own issues there. He always struck me as being the worst kind of philosopher, even besides the fact that he never had an original thought in his life. He held everyone to ridiculously high standards, his two eldest sons especially, while never once noticing how far from his own mark he fell. His own philosophical framework was either an exercise in great hypocrisy, praising work as the path of true manhood and self-sufficiency, while he himself lived off his father's fortune and never held a job, or an act of self-justification, warping theological thought so that the waywardness of sinning, such as his own drinking problem and lusts, was actually somehow a path to becoming more divine. He preached that parents must allow their children to be their own selves and make their own way, and yet he demanded total obedience and deference from his children. In short, he constructed his philosophy as a way to avoid ever experiencing a moment of self-doubt or questioning. As the eldest son, William felt enormous pressure both to please his father and to achieve a level of respectability and renown. There was a burden on him not to disappoint and not to fail. The problem was that his father's definition of failure kept expanding to encompass anything William tried to do. Henry Sr. was supportive when his sons dabbled in interests, but when they decided on a specific course of action, their chosen field was suddenly never good enough, never important enough, never worthy of his son's great potential. His father discouraged William at every turn, and so he skipped from profession to profession, trying to make contact with his father's approval, only to have it yanked away like Lucy's football, again and again. Henry Jr. noticed this perverse tendency in their father, reflecting that the message they received was never to dismiss any suggestion of an alternative. He continues in his memoirs, "What we were to do instead was just be something, something unconnected with specific doing, something free and uncommitted, something finer in short than being that, whatever it was, might consist of." Henry Sr. wanted his sons to live in a space of limitless potentiality, while he continued to judge them harshly on the lack of concrete results. "Every person gets the father they require to turn into the people they need to be," a colleague once said to me. But this colleague has flowy hair, wears a lot of purple, and uses words like fate and destiny in an enviably sincere and unironic way. But here's the truth. It was these decades of indecision that made William James unique. Later, he was able to draw on his art training, his medical training, his philosophical learning, his spiritual experimentation, his psychology background, to create a philosophy rooted in body, soul, and mind. And without a crazy-making father forcing him in one direction and then another, he never would have, God damn it, lived up to his full potential. That doesn't mean I do not still sometimes yell at William James's father in my head when I am reading their letters. A friend just back from Latvia told me that the way the Russians dealt with the mosquitoes there, big as hummingbirds, was to lace their own food and the food of their livestock with insecticides. They would poison themselves and their own property to kill off the parasites. With a parent like Henry Sr., it would be possible to take the Russians' lead, to poison your own ambition so that no one undeserving could lay claim to your success. But then I was always more spiteful than James was. I doubt the thought occurred to him. "I am conscious of a desire I never had before so strongly or so permanently, of narrowing and deepening the channel of my intellectual activity, of economizing my feeble energies and consequently treating with more respect
the few things I shall devote them to. This temper may be a transient one, but something tells me that practically my salvation depends on following such a plan.
William James, Journal, Berlin. I moved to Berlin with my life distilled down to 2 suitcases. I'm still not sure if that was an act of pessimism or optimism. The rest was hauled away by my new Craigslist friends, while I drank vodka on ice and nodded when they asked, "Are you sure this is free?" Nothing went into storage. Nothing was given to friends to hold on to just in case this scheme didn't work out and I needed to come back. Maybe in the end it'll be one of those defining moments that makes all the difference in retrospect. Who knows how long it'll take for me to get far enough.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.